In a moment, the ceremony will be start, and I would like to invite everyone to please have a seat. Thank you.
Check microphone.
Celebrate this joyous morning. We are sincerely grateful of your presence, and it's been a truly blessed moment when two people are finally joined together in a sacred matrimonial ceremony. And in a moment, Jonathan Javier Barki and Amanda Kosasi will pledge their love and promise to each other to the Lord. Let us now stand to welcome the bride, Amanda Kosasi, and the father of the bride, Mr. Amir Kosasi, and praise to the Lord. Once again, let's welcome Amanda Kosasi and father of the bride, Mr. Amir Kosasi. Thank you.
Jemaat yang berbahagia, mari kita sama-sama mempersiapkan hati kita untuk memuji dan menyembah Tuhan. Let's prepare our hearts. Just want to worship the Lord together. Let's sing together. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wrapped himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. All will see how great is our God. It's age to age. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hand. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb. The Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Always sing, how great is our God. We sing name above all names. Let's praise Him together. As we praise You, Jesus.
Name above all names, You're worthy of all praise. My heart will sing, how great is our God.
Oh, name above all names.
Name above all names.
You are worthy, God.
You are worthy of all praise.
With all our hearts, let's lift up this name together. Here we go.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Always see how great is our
to worship the name above all names, the wonderful name of Jesus.
Great, You love me. was greater. What could separate us now? What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing could touch this. What a beautiful name it is. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the bones of sin and death. Heavens are roaring. Praise of your glory. For we are raised to life again. You have. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of
what a powerful
Jesus.
Name,
what a powerful name it is, the name
was so
of
powerful.
Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Father God, we thank you for such an incredible day. God, we know that your word says that the attributes of your character are revealed in all creation. And to be able to see your creation shining down on Jonathan and Amanda this morning, we praise your holy name. Father, we just pray that every single heart here today would be sensitive to what you're doing in this place. Lord, that we would recognize the gift of marriage as what it is. It truly is a gift. It's a covenant given to us to help us understand the love and the covenant that you made with us at the cross. So Father, we pray that today would be a benchmark in the life of John and Amanda. Lord, that from today forward, they would forever understand that they are yours, and the life you have called them to is a life of unity, purpose, empowered by your grace. So we thank you so much. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Please have a seat. Please be seated. Silakan duduk. All right. Man, what an incredible day. I love these flowers. So beautiful. So good. Amanda, you look so gorgeous. Everything. Amazing. Your jewelry, your everything goes together. It's like amazing. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. JB. Also gorgeous. Not as gorgeous of her, but you're looking good. You're looking good. It's a good day today. I'd like to be the first person to welcome you into the Beautiful Wives Club. You made it. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You guys are going to be doing great. You know, I love being able to be here with you guys and celebrate with you here, because today kind of sets a pace for the rest of your life. You know, weddings are so cool and they're so beautiful. They're always so beautiful, all weddings, right? However, They're never perfect. There's always little things that you have to change, and it requires flexibility and patience. But isn't that true to the life that you're now choosing to live with one another? It's not going to be a life of perfection, where everything goes as it is to plan, but it's a life of flexibility, and even more so, it's a life of humility. You know, in Genesis chapter 3, when it says that Adam and Eve sinned and they fell from God, it said that Adam was doomed to work the ground forever and ever, but his work would never satisfy him. And it said that Eve would desire her husband and find her identity in him, and he would rule over her. See, the issue was, in their fallen state, is they stopped relying on God for everything they needed, and they started relying on other things to bring satisfaction in their life. And if I could just speak right to both of you today, whenever I sit down with a couple that's going through it, it's usually the same problem. See, the devil's not creative. He tricks men into thinking that one day they will find their identity in their work, and he tricks women into thinking one day they'll find their identity in their marriage and their family. But God's heart, and now that Jesus has come, we're not under that anymore. Now we both find our identity in Christ alone. We find our resource, we find our love in Christ alone. I'm going to give you a few keys that I believe are really going to bless your relationship. Then we're going to do our vows, exchange our rings, kiss a little bit, and party. Just a little bit. Does that sound good, guys? All right. The first thing I want to encourage both of you in, as you start this journey, is to plant yourself in the house of God. You know, it says in Psalms 93, the righteous will flourish like the palm tree, and they will grow like a cedar in Lebanon. When they are planted in the courts of their God, they will still bear fruit in old age. I love that last part because it speaks to bearing fruit in a season where you're not supposed to bear fruit. See, when you understand that you are a part of something bigger than you, when you humble your heart and say, it's not just me and Jesus, but it's me and Jesus and his church, then God can work through your life to create fruit and blessing and opportunity, even when the season doesn't call for it. I know you might be thinking, you know, Pastor Alex, of course that's your first point, because you're a pastor, you want us to come to church. But no matter where you are in this world, my encouragement is that you would pray carefully and let your roots go down deep into God's house. You know, it says they're like a palm tree in Lebanon. And we're not in Lebanon, but we have palm trees nonetheless. And when you drive through Jakarta and you see the palm trees, seldom do you see them fall. You see wind and you see rain, but you don't see the trees falling. Instead, you see them bending and flexing with the wind. See, where you put your roots determines your ability to last in the storms and to stand tall when everything around you is trying to pull you down. So that's my encouragement. Let your roots go down deep. Find a church and say, this is my home. Take the good, the bad, and the ugly and say, I'm a part of something bigger than me. The second thing I want to encourage you in is to commit yourself to godly community. Hebrews 10 says, let us consider how to stimulate one another to good deeds, never forsaking coming together as the habit of some, but always encourage one another. You know, in this time, the writer was writing to the Hebrews because the home churches that were meeting and the more public churches that were meeting were under persecution. The members were being killed and dragged through the streets, so they begin to shrink back in fear, and they allow fear to be their God, and they stopped coming together. So the writer said, listen, never stop. See, it's when you come together that you're able to stimulate one another. The word he actually used, the original language, was to stir each other up. See, sometimes, bro, There's things sitting down in you that God has called you to and spoken over your life, but because of your lack of community, they stay at the bottom and they aren't stirred up. But when you commit yourself to godly community, those things are stirred up and encouraged regularly. You're reminded of who you are. You have friends that are faithful, but also faithful for you. See, JB, if I can just be honest, there's going to be a day. I mean, look at her, man. Come on now. She's gorgeous. She's so pretty. She's so sweet. The other night at dinner, she was just so composed and so polite about everything. I was like, good, we got to get more drinks in this girl. You know what I'm saying? But listen, there's going to be a day where you look at your wife and you say, oh my Lord, I married a crazy woman. Who is this girl? I can't do this. This is nuts. And you're going to call your bros. You're going to call your cousins. You're going to call, you're going to say, dude, I can't do this. This is crazy. She wasn't like this. She tricked me. She acted all normal. And then, you know what I mean? That's what's going to happen. But you don't need guy friends that are going to say, psh, don't worry about her. I'll take you to the club. We'll find a new girl. No, what you need are friends that are going to say, JB, if she's acting crazy, it's because you made her crazy. Now go back and apologize to your wife. And Amanda, he's always so sweet, yeah? He's always smiling. He's like the forever optimist. He's like, no, this is great, guys. Don't worry. It's going to be awesome with everything. But there's going to be a day when you look at him and you say, I married the meanest man in the world. He doesn't care about me. He doesn't love me. What happened? I don't know. And you're going to call your girlfriends and you're going to say, he's so mean. I don't know what to do. What you don't need, they're right there. Hey, listen to this part. This is for you. What you don't need are girlfriends that are going to say, you know what? Just come sleep at my house. You don't need him. You're a strong, independent woman. No, what you need are girlfriends that are going to say, you chose him. He was your choice. Now go back with humility and reconcile the relationship. See, that's what happens when we submit ourselves to godly community. The last thing I want to encourage you in is to serve God by serving each other. It says in Colossians chapter 3, to work willingly at whatever you do as though you are working for the Lord, not for people. Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance, and your master is Christ. You know, it breaks my heart when I see couples that were so passionate, they were so on fire for one another, but the fire dies down, seasons change, and the intimacy begins to dissipate. Oftentimes, when you see a relationship like that, there's a common theme. See, sometimes in our marriage, we refer to our marriage like a contract, not a covenant. We start to think about it as one hand washing the other, where if I do my part of the contract and you do your part of the contract, then we can move forward as partners. But that's simply not the case. We are not entering a contract today. We are entering a covenant. You should never treat your marriage like a business. If you're at a meeting at Starbucks, JB, with one of the guys from your team, and you were wrapping up, and then you reached over and grabbed his hand and massaged it a little bit and looked him in the eye and said, I just love doing business with you. That would be a little weird. It would also be really weird if you started treating her like a business partner. Treat her like your wife. Don't love her because you think she deserves it. Love her because God has loved you so, so much. Even when he doesn't deserve it, even when he frustrates you, serve him and love him, because Jesus has faithfully served you with all of his life. That's how we operate in a covenant of marriage. That's it. Three things. Easy, right? Sounds easy. You got 60 to 70 years to work it out. Please go ahead and stand with me as we enter the portion of the ceremony for the vows. Jonathan, before you prepare to read your vows, Amanda, I would like you to answer this question for me. Do you, Jonathan, take Amanda to be your wife, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony?
Yes, I do.
All right. Please continue with your vows.
Thank you. Dear Mandy, it took me 9 long years to figure out what I wanted in life. But when I did, God put you right in front of me. I'm grateful and blessed to be marrying the love of my life, the first person to ever help me understand the beautiful meaning of love. Love that is filled with joy, that gives me peace, and that I'm willing to sacrifice for. Thank you for giving me a chance, for opening up your heart, and to accept me just as I am. Mandy, I promise to keep you safe and to hold your hand through the good and the rough times. I promise to be there for you, to comfort you with silly jokes, and to put a smile on your face. I promise to follow you on all your foodie missions and to remove cilantro from our dishes. I promise to keep the lights on before we sleep and to be there to welcome you home from your girls' night out. Mandy, I vow to build our home centered in Christ and to always put our family first. I'm excited for the journey ahead of us, for what God has in store for us, and I cannot imagine pursuing that with anyone else. Thank you, baby. Love you.
Beautiful. Amanda, as you prepare to read your vows, could you please answer this question?
Yes.
Do you, Amanda, take Jonathan to be your husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony?
Yes, I do.
Good job.
Dear Jonathan, I used to always pray to God about the guy I'll end up with. I would describe him down to a T, just to be extra sure that God got the message and doesn't send me the wrong person. I know, Pastor, God doesn't make mistakes, but I was young and I just really wanted to be extra safe. I wanted someone smart, I said. Someone kind, someone responsible, someone who would prioritize family over everything else. I even added in the totally necessary things, like someone who likes sports, and if possible, also someone who's taller than me, please, and someone who at least I will find remotely cute. Well, years passed by, and I figured that God probably forgot or had better things to do rather than listen to my super long list. Except he didn't, because he gave me you. John, you're everything I've ever prayed for, and more. I'm constantly in awe of the person that you are, how you can be so strong yet so empathetic at the same time, how you constantly invest in people, making time for them even if it means you can't have time to relax on the weekends. You inspire me to be a better person every single day. You make me happier than I ever thought I could be, and I'm so grateful that I'll get to spend the rest of my days with you. As we embark on this new chapter of our lives together, I promise to be the best wife and mother I can to our future children. I promise to cherish and honor you, to be faithful to you, and to choose you every single day, even when it gets hard. I promise to be your armor bearer, encouraging you to pursue your biggest dreams. I promise to listen and to always share your burdens and pains when you are facing challenges. I promise to stop checking the football scores so I can share your excitement in watching Manchester United reruns. And I promise to stop asking you when I should be buying more Bitcoin. While I don't know what the future holds for us, know that I'll be right here by your side through whatever comes our way, because I truly believe that we're better together and that our best days are still ahead of us.
That's beautiful. At this time, we will begin the exchange of the rings. Thank you so much. Beautiful. All right, first I'm going to give this ring to you, and I want you to take her hand in your hand, okay? And I want you to g- get ready to kind of slide that ring on her ring finger. Okay. And or that one, either one, and you can choose, yeah. And then slide it about halfway. Okay, stop right there. You're not married yet. Okay. And look into her eyes, and I'm going to tell you what these rings mean. See, the issue with Hollywood and Hallmark is we look at something like a wedding ring and we buy into the idea is that it symbolizes our love for one another, but that's not true. See, the reason we choose a ring is because it doesn't have a beginning and it doesn't have an end. It's forever. And we know that your love had a beginning. And one day when you go home to be with Jesus, but what a ring does symbolize, what love doesn't have a beginning and never has an end, is the love of God for you. It says that Jesus has loved you before the foundation of the world. That means he, before breathing life into Adam, looked at you, Jonathan, and said, I'm going to be so proud of you on the 29th of November, 2021, as you walk down that aisle. And he looked at you, Amanda, and said, oh my gosh, girl, you're going to look great in that dress. I can't wait to see you all grown up, living the life I've called you to. He's always loved you, and he always will. So when we doubt our ability to love one another, when we doubt our ability to keep this covenant with one another, we don't think about what I can do, but we think about everything he's done for us. Go ahead. As you slide this ring on her finger, please repeat this after me.
I, Jonathan, you take Amanda to be my wife. I promise to love you and keep you. We are now consecrated to me as my wife. From this day forward, I give you this ring as a symbol of our unity bound together by Christ's love.
This ring, you could take JB's nice manicured hand there, and as you slide on his finger and you hold his hand and you look into his eyes, please repeat this after me. Jonathan,
oh, sorry. Jonathan, you're now consecrated to me as my husband. From this day forward, I give you this ring as a symbol of our unity, bound together by Christ's love.
In closing, I just want to go back to Adam and Eve. See, in Christ, because we're not bound to our work, and we're not bound to identity in our marriage and family, our identity is bound in Christ. I think it's appropriate that we look at the original plan as God formed the first man and woman. See, it says that he took the rib from Adam and he made Eve. See, he could have taken it from Adam's feet. He also could have taken it from Adam's head, but he took it from his rib. See, it was God's intention that forever and ever, as long as they were on earth, they were to walk side by side. And that the bride of Adam would be close to his heart. It would be there with him, a part of him in every way, under his arm, there, by his side. And Amanda, you are forever to be by the side of JB. Forever and always, you will walk next to him. You'll be his biggest champion. You'll be his biggest support. You will love him like nobody else. And Jonathan, you are to always put your arm around your wife. Never stop holding her. Never stop pulling her in. You know what I love about the rib is it's right next to the heart. Never hide your heart from her. Let the guard down. Show her everything. And as you continue to do this together, you'll begin to understand God's heart for man and wife. And that's why it says in the book of Mark, God made them male and female from the beginning of creation. This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife. The two are united into one, and since they are no longer two but one, let no one split apart what God has joined together. Jonathan and Amanda, by the power invested in me, by our beautiful nation of Indonesia, and by Jesus Christ our Savior, I now pronounce you husband and wife. You may kiss the bride. Friends and family, the husband and wife today have chosen that their first course of action is to give honor and appreciation to their mother and father. Friends and family, as we close the ceremony today, I think it's only appropriate that we all pray a special prayer of blessing and a charge as they enter in this new season of marriage. Please bow your heads with me. So, Father God, we just pray that forever and always, as long as these two walk the earth, they would pursue your best, that they would never settle, that they would never go after second, but they would say, I am a child of God. I want the Father's best for my life. And God, we pray that your glory and your favor would be seen in every area of their life, that they'd be blessed physically, financially, spiritually, emotionally. Lord, in every area, people look and say, man, look at God's favor working in their marriage. Things that are hard and challenging for others, they would just feel like it's covered by your grace. And the glory would always come back to you, God. And Father, we just pray that their marriage would be a legacy. That one day, their grandkids and great-grandkids would remember and say, I want a marriage like Oma Amanda and Opa Jonathan. That it would be rich and it would set a pace and a generational blessing for the generations to come. We thank you. We pray these things and believe these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, then it is my privilege and honor to introduce for the very first time Mrs. and Mr. Jonathan Barkey.
Now we would like to take a picture together with pastor and the bride and the groom. Pastor and also wife. And the groom would like to say speech for the friends in YouTube.
Hi, dear friends. Dear friends on YouTube, on Zoom, all our friends and family. Thank you so much for joining us. We wish all of you are here. We're sorry that not everyone can be here today. We're very blessed, we're very thankful for your time and for hopefully enjoying the ceremony. This is a really special day for us, and you know, we hope to see all of you in different places around the world and catch up with all of you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Next, we would like to continue the photo session with the bridegroom, groom parents, and groom siblings.